y'all doing? Doing pretty good. Here with Brad, our shape-shifting vision casting leader, and Drago, our Russian dog. Been outside all day. He's filthy, and he knows he's getting a bath later. Say, guess that TV theme music from the intro, and you'll win a prize. Tell them what they'll win, Brad.
Mike Tyson's punch out from Nintendo.
So today we're going to be looking at another Easter sermon. I've watched a lot of Easter sermons in the last couple of weeks, and they all say the same thing. The Easter message has been changed into this just kind of like non-biblical message. What's the big deal about the resurrection? I mean, why the resurrection? Why is it a big deal? Why do we celebrate it every year? Well, it can be summed up in one verse, Romans chapter 4, verse 25. Christ was crucified for our sins and raised for our justification. What does that mean? The one who atoned for our sins is still alive to justify us. He justifies us before the Father. We are justified in Christ. As long as he lives, we are justified. And he lives, he will live forever. He is our sacrifice. You know, when John the Baptist told his disciples to go follow Jesus, they did. And they didn't let him out of their sight until the night he was crucified, of course. But up to that point, man, they stayed right with him. They were like, I'm not letting this guy out of my sight. In fact, when Jesus asked them if they wanted to leave him, when 10, 15, 20,000 people left him in one day, Peter said, "Where would we go, Lord? You have the words of life. We're not letting you out of our sight." Why did they stick with so close to Jesus during his ministry? Well, it's because of what John the Baptist told them. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. There's your sacrifice before God. Now, they were like, okay, if that's my sacrifice, I'm not letting him out of my sight. I want to make sure that he stays well, that he stays alive, that he doesn't come in any trouble. We just want to make sure we're close to our sacrifice, see? And this is what we learn from the resurrection, that our sacrifice lives. He ever lives. Our justification lives. He was raised for our justification. And so every year we need to be reminded of that, that no matter what happens in this world, no matter what we do, no matter what we feel, whatever, we need to be reminded that our sacrifice is alive, that he ever lives for our justification, to justify us before the face of the Father, before the face of the Father. This has been the message of Easter for the last 2,000 years, but not anymore, it would seem. So anyway, here's Stephen Furtick and his Easter sermon, his 2021 Easter sermon, and also his image and audio has been changed because last year they had our channel shut down for taking a look, a critical look at the product that they produce. So we changed it around so we can get around that. The link to the full sermon is in the about section. I don't have anything to hide, unlike some people. But anyway, here we go.
Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Be careful what you ask for. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Now listen to this. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Can you say amen? That's the word of God. Now, let me give a title to the sermon and you can give it to your neighbor. Tell them, I know you're a good person.
Hey, Drago, I know you're a good person. He's drinking out of the toilet.
Tell him, I know you're a Christian.
Hey, Brad.
Don't touch me!
I know you're nice. Tell him, I know you're moody. Now, I don't want to start anything, but tell him, I know you're kind of crazy.
Offense taken!
Now, but that's not the title. Here's the title. Come the title say. That's not all you are.
Oh, I have a bad feeling about this.
Now, be seated. And let's talk about
Jesus, our justification in heaven, whoever lives to make intercession for us.
Thomas. Or as you judgmental church people like to call him, Doubting Thomas.
Well, I mean, Jesus called him Doubting Thomas. He said to him, Thomas, do not be doubting, but believing. I've got a feeling this is going to be a copy of Craig Groeschel's sermon, Exonerating Thomas. The only question is, did Craig get it from Steve, or did Steve get it from Craig?
This is what we do. We love to label stuff. Because if I label it, I can be lazy. Because I can think I know you because you remind me of something that's in myself that I won't admit. This Easter, I would like to talk about Thomas.
This Easter, Pastor Stephen Furtick would like to talk about Thomas. What do you think Thomas himself would think about that? Hey, Thomas, did you know that preachers and churches today are preaching you to their people on Easter? What do you think Thomas would say to that, Brad?
Not cool.
And suggest to you that if any of the other disciples had been in his same situation, they would have had his same doubt. The Bible says that Thomas wasn't there when Jesus showed up. Now, remember, he rose from the dead. He showed himself to Mary Magdalene, not to the boys first, because he knows that women have the ability to feel and not be so calculative about everything and know things that their minds can't conceive and see things spiritually that men are blind to because we are so ego-focused.
I see you reading your psychology book.
That we can't even connect with one another, let alone the resurrected Son of God. You like that pandering I did to the female demographic? I mean, that was good, wasn't it? But I really believe that. Holly was with a bunch of other pastors' wives a while back, and she was saying, like, oh, it's so good, and we opened up, and we talked about this, and we talked about that. And I said, if that had been the pastors of those churches and not the women who are co-pastors or pastors' wives, all we would have talked about is things that started with how many.
Here's a how many question for you. How many minutes until Stephen Furtick talks about Jesus here on Easter Sunday? Five minutes.
You know how I think Jesus would call him? I was thinking about this. What would Jesus call Thomas?
Wow, somebody says. Well, what does Stephen Furtick think Jesus would call Thomas? My mind is blown. We could be thinking about what Thomas called Jesus, my Lord and my God, but no, we're wondering what Jesus might have called Thomas, because the big point of this narrative is Thomas. We learned that from Craig Groeschel, right? In the worst Easter sermon of 2021.
Called the one that wasn't there. What would Jesus call the one who came back a week later to make a special guest appearance to? He thought so much of him that he showed back up.
He thought a lot of Thomas, Jesus did, apparently. Thomas was special. There was more to Thomas than meets the eye, apparently. More to Jesus than meets the eye? I guess we'll see.
Maybe Jesus would call him.
Get your notepads out!
Honest Thomas. Because what he said, I think he said a good thing. He said, I've got to see it for myself. And there comes a time when your faith in God and what your grandparents taught you or what you learned on a flannograph in a Sunday school can't really get you through the real complications of adult life.
What, the word of God isn't enough to get us through? The confession of Thomas here in this gospel recorded for us so that we might believe in him is not enough? It's not enough. We need to experience him. We need to be like Thomas, even though Jesus himself told us not to be like Thomas. He told us to rather believe what Thomas said. Jesus told us that here in the text. Stephen Furtick is teaching us.
So what he said wasn't, I won't believe. He said, I won't believe unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side. I won't believe. Unless, what would it take for you to believe?
That Jesus rose from the dead? The testimony of his apostles. The testimony of Thomas. The testimony of the apostles Jesus sent to tell me to believe in him. The Gospel of John, for instance, it was written so that I might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing I might have life in his name. Jesus told his apostles earlier in the upper room that anyone who rejects them rejects him. It pleases him that we should believe the testimony of his apostles, not having seen, but having heard from the mouths of his apostles. That's how people believe. That's how everyone believed who has believed in all the 2,000 years following this event right here in John.
He's already seen so much, Thomas has. He's seen a lot. And John says Jesus did so much, we couldn't write it all down. So John, in making this, we call it a book, his gospel account, he says, I put the ones in the book that would serve as a sign so you could believe. And he includes seven of them, which is a significant number, especially for the Jewish mind, because it was 7 days of creation, you know. And John is saying here, I'm gonna show you seven things. He starts talking about the signs in John chapter 2, where Jesus turned the water into wine at a wedding. Then in chapter 4, Jesus heals this official's son. It's crazy because Jesus didn't even have to go physically to the place in order to heal the boy. All it took was for the man to believe. It was his faith that made his son well. In John chapter 5, there's a man trying to get to the water, and Jesus says, well, it's a good thing that the water showed up, since you can't move, because the man was actually paralyzed. He could not get to the water, so Jesus brought water to him. That's the third sign. One of the miracles that we've heard a lot about if we were around church was when Jesus fed 5,000 men, women, and children. The "and children" is significant in this particular sign because when they found this little boy in John chapter 6, they said, here is a boy. To them, he looked like a boy. He was carrying a buffet. Isn't that amazing? Look at your neighbor again and say, that's not all you are.
Look at your neighbor and say, isn't Jesus amazing? There's so much more to him, so much more to Jesus that John ran out of words, ran out of paper, ran out of ink, ran out of books, ran out of breath. But no, there's more to us. There's more to us than meets the eye. There's more to this little boy, you know, than meets the eye. What do you think that little boy would say to us now if he knew that people were actually preaching his attributes, preaching him from this text of Jesus? What do you think they would say, Brad?
I don't know whether to laugh or vomit.
When Jesus went walking on the water, they thought he was a ghost. They didn't recognize him at first. They didn't see him at first. They felt fear at first, not faith. And then in John chapter 9, I think it is, you can check all these later. I'm giving you a Bible study for the next week, by the way. You could go through all of this. Where this man was born blind, and Jesus healed the man born blind, which was amazing. But the greatest thing that he did
And the blind man believed on the Son of God and was saved. That's the amazing thing about that miracle.
To show who he was, started with what he didn't do. My favorite story in the Bible last year was the story of Lazarus in John chapter 11. I spent the greater part of the year off and on looking at this story. And I want to show you something that's in the story that I think might relate to your season of life as well. If you have John chapter 20 right now, just maybe put that little ribbon in your Bible. Who am I kidding? Like y'all brought paper to church today. Just mark it on the screen and go to John chapter 11 for just a moment. Because if we flip back to John chapter 11, it will show us something about who Jesus really is. Now, John says, I can't tell you everything, but I told you enough that you can believe for the part that you can't see.
Well, no, that's not what John said. He said what he has written is enough so that we might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and then by believing we might have life in his name. Life, here in John's gospel, meaning eternal life. Eternal life, as opposed to eternal wrath. This is what Jesus said in John chapter 3.
No one has ascended to heaven, but he who came down from heaven, that is, the Son of Man, who is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God.
Eternal life, eternally justified, eternal righteousness, because we have believed in the eternal sacrifice. Whoever lives, who sacrificed himself and yet lived and ever lives to justify us before the face of God.
I can't tell you everything that he did, but I gave you enough to believe. God said, I'll give you enough to go on. So when Moses asked God, who are you? He said, I am. You don't have time for me to tell you all that I am. Because the moment that I tell you exactly what I am, you will label me.
Yeah, that's not really the Bible.
God didn't say that in the text. How does Stephen Furtick know this? Or I should say, how does Stephen Furtick think he knows this?
And the moment you label me, you will limit me.
You know, I don't want to sound unbiblical.
It definitely doesn't say that. I'm no Bible scholar, but I know we can't limit God by what we call him or what we don't call him. That's not, the Bible doesn't say that, not in the text. It doesn't. It doesn't say that anywhere.
It's like this. People will say, that must be a Pentecostal church. That must be a Baptist church. That must be a, what they say sometimes, they'll say.
Furtick church.
Oh, they'll say, I remember one person said sometimes, I don't like how Elevation mixes different genres. It should either be worship or gospel, not both. So the definitions I found in the Bible confused me because I thought worship was our job description and gospel was our message.
Well, I think, Stephen, that some of the confusion might be from how you yourself have defined your own church.
I want Elevation Church to be a church for the overlooked, for the unloved. Not for us to have as many different varieties of Bible studies. We got Beth Moore and Kay Arthur and Joyce Meyer. No, you know, we got Jesus. We preach him. We preach so that people can come to faith in Christ, and we want them to get in a small group and serve so that other people can meet Christ. If you know Jesus, I am sorry to break it to you. This church is not for you.
So you say that your church is for unbelievers, but unbelievers cannot worship God. In fact, God says it is an abomination for unbelievers to worship him. He detests it. And we know that unbelievers become believers by hearing the gospel. Jesus himself said this in the text you are teaching us. So I think the confusion comes in when you say you are a church for the lost, a church built so that unbelievers might believe in Jesus. Why then do you not preach the gospel? Like you're not preaching it now in this Easter sermon. You're telling lost people that there's more to them than meets the eye. Hey, is that the gospel, Stephen? No. And these people here at your church don't even know it's not the gospel. These people oohing and aahing over every word you say, they don't know what the gospel is because you haven't taught it to them. I mean, if you really wanted unbelievers to know Jesus, you'd tell them about Jesus instead of telling them about Thomas and David and Abraham and Moses. And you tell unbelievers about people like Thomas and David and Abraham and Moses because they can be like Thomas and David and Abraham and Moses. But they can't be like Jesus, which is why Jesus had to die for them. He had to live a life they could not live so that they might live in him for all eternity. Why would you do that, Stephen? Yeah, Stephen, he doesn't preach the gospel here on Easter Sunday. You know what he preaches? Instead of the gospel, he preaches this.
So let me break this down real simple. I was talking to a YouTuber the other day. And there's nothing uncommon about YouTubers, but he's 59. And he was sharing with me how he had been a music producer. And then when that stopped and he was down to his last little bit of money in the bank account, I told you this story. I'm going to tell them now.
We got Jesus.
He kind of was at the point in his life where, you know, by the time you're 54, he was 54 when he started his channel, you kind of have a pretty good idea of what you can and can't do. Right? Like, I mean, one day his intern walks in, he told me the story, he said, one day his intern walks in and says, you should start a YouTube channel. And the beautiful thing about this guy, he's got the grayest gray hair, shocking white, like the transfiguration of Jesus Christ himself.
We preach him.
And he said, there's nobody with hair like this on YouTube. I'm a producer. This is what I do. I'm a music teacher. This is what I do. I don't even know how to make the videos. Now, I wouldn't be telling you this story if he tried and failed. Obviously, he succeeded.
We preach so that people can come to faith in Christ.
Right? I was studying. There's all these other YouTubers who are younger and more hair and different colored hair and all of these different things. See?
We do one thing.
See, I'm telling you this story because
we preach Jesus so people far from God can know Jesus.
You can tell yourself a summary of what you are and what you're not based on the experience that you've had, not the potential that you carry.
But we know what we came to do. Luke 19:10, seek and save that which is lost.
Stephen thinks this is preaching Jesus. And the people applauding think it's preaching Jesus too, because they don't know who Jesus is, because they have a pastor who doesn't tell them about Jesus. That really is that simple. So we need to pray for Elevation Church, pray for Stephen Furtick, pray for the millions of people who listen to this every week. I've met many of them who've walked away from the faith, walked away from their marriages. Just, you know, it's all about them. Stephen's all about them. They think the gospel's all about them. They think everything's all about them. And I don't know where they could have ever gotten that idea.
That's not all you are.
Y'all take care. I'll talk to you again soon.